2 years before his election as Pope John Paul II, Cardinal Karl Wojtyla said, "We are today before the greatest battle that mankind has ever seen. I do not believe that the Christian community has completely understood it." The Cardinal was pointing to the critical spiritual battle in progress between the woman, the Blessed Virgin Mary, and the red dragon, the devil, predicted in Genesis and described in the Apocalypse. This battle takes concrete form in our daily lives. On one side stand those who faithfully adhere to God's teachings and commandments. On the other are those who promote secularism, relativism, and religious indifference. These insidious forces, based on human-centeredness and rejection of the supernatural, have even infiltrated inside of the Church, attempting to destroy the authentic Catholic faith and traditional Catholic life. This spiritual battle is being waged with special intensity in Korea, where almost 20,000 Catholics were martyred in the 18th and 19th centuries, where millions of people lost their lives during the Korean War in the 1950s, and where the abortion rate is among the highest in the world. From 1985, the Lord and the Blessed Mother have been giving urgent messages and miraculous signs to the entire human race through Julia Kim, a wife and mother of four, in the small city of Naju, Korea, calling for their repentance and reformation of their lives. At the same time, the devil has been trying relentlessly to slander and block these works by the Lord and the Blessed Mother. What is happening in Naju is a loud and anxious echo of the original messages and signs of our Lord for the salvation of the human race 2,000 years ago. The devil is whispering to us that we do not need to repent of our sins or follow God's commandments, and that we don't have to pay attention to the messages and signs in Naju. The devil wants us to believe that our own ambitions and concerns are more important than the will of God. The persecution of Julia and the pilgrims in Naju has dramatically escalated since October 2007, just 1 month before the Korean bishops made their ad limina visit to the Holy See. On October 31st, MBC TV in Seoul, one of the largest TV stations in Korea, sent their reporters and cameramen to Naju to collect evidence. 2 weeks later, on November 13th, MBC TV aired a 15-minute report on Naju all over Korea. In this report, MBC TV portrayed Julia Kim as a fraud who seeks wealth and fame by fabricating miracles and messages, and the supporters of Naju as her credulous victims. MBC TV did not hesitate to fill its video with distorted information and false accusations in order to damage the reputation of Naju. When the MBC reporters first came to Naju on October 31, 2007, they said that they had already visited the priests in the Gwangju Archdiocese, who have been the leading opponents of Naju for the past 2 decades. While they were conducting their investigation in Naju, the MBC TV reporters deliberately avoided interviewing the individuals who have experienced miraculous healings and others who have witnessed the miraculous signs. It was obvious that these reporters were heavily prejudiced against Naju with the false information that the Gwangju priests gave them before they came to Naju. In addition, a secular TV network like MBC is not qualified for evaluating matters that belong to the Catholic Church. Being outsiders to the Church, how can its reporters be expected to understand and make correct judgment on the matters related to the Catholic faith, such as messages and miracles? It is especially regrettable that the Gwangju Archdiocese accepted this secular TV report as worthy information for discerning the events in Naju, and then even presented it to the Holy See during the Korean bishop's ad limina visit to the Vatican in late November 2007. It is doubtful that the Vatican officials accepted this video as a piece of reliable information. The MBC video, however, has been highly effective in turning public opinion in Korea against Naju. Many of the priests and laypeople who had been neutral on Naju became angry opponents after seeing this video. Copies of the video have also been circulated in many other countries. It seemed that irreparable damages were done to the public image of Naju and its chances for being officially approved by the church. The video we present here is an attempt to repair these damages by countering the false information in the NBC video with a true fact about Naju. Bishop Eduardo Sangsun of the Ruteng Diocese in Indonesia had visited Naju twice in recent years and then invited Julia to his own diocese. A group of 33 Koreans, including Julia, arrived in Ruteng on March 24, 2007 and stayed for 4 days. On March 26th, Bishop Sangsun concelebrated Mass in his cathedral with a large group of priests. An overflow crowd of 70,000 of the faithful gathered at the cathedral for the Mass. Afterwards, Julia spent almost 2 hours praying over many individuals. Among them were 9 children who had been blind, deaf, or mute, and were all cured through Julia's prayers. Witnessing these healings, the people shouted and wept for joy and praised God. Several months later, NBC TV sent a reporter to Ruteng to take some video footage to include in their broadcast. The reporter, however, interviewed only a few teachers at the orphanage for the handicapped children who were not present at the healings during Julia's visit. Based on the shaky testimonies of these unqualified witnesses, NBC TV reported that there was no clear evidence that miraculous healings had occurred during Julia's visit. The reporter did interview one boy named Yuris, who was healed of his blindness. But the reporter denied that a healing had occurred, saying that this boy had not been completely blind before Julia's visit. This report was later contradicted by a sister who had actually witnessed the healing and had observed the boy for years. On June 13, 2007, Julia returned to Ruteng, Indonesia, and went to the orphanage for the blind, deaf, and mute children. Again, she prayed over the children, and 7 of them were healed. Mrs. Mira Guizot of Indonesia, who has visited Naju many times, testified about the children who were healed during Julia's visit to Indonesia.
Several doctors from Australia come to Ruteng every October to check the condition of the handicapped children. When they came last year, they were surprised to see Yuris with greatly improved eyesight and reading a book. The doctor said that Yuris could now attend a normal school. When I telephoned Yuris and asked him what had happened, he answered, "I am happy because I can see so well. Mama Julia prayed for me. I am so happy. Thank you for calling me."
I accompanied Mrs. Julia Kim to the orphanage to see the handicapped children. I heard that several blind and deaf children had been healed during Julia's first visit in March 2007, and I confirmed that this was true. I met several of these children who had been healed. I also met the sister who was taking care of these children and testified that they had been healed. It was a proof that Julia had the power of healing received from God. I hope that my testimony will be useful in the process of the careful and thorough investigation of the apparitions in Naju. I, Eduardus Sangsun, the Bishop of the Ruteng Diocese in Indonesia, give this testimony regarding the spiritual fruits due to the sharing of faith experiences with Julia Kim from Naju, South Korea. During the two visits of March and June of 2007, I witnessed many changes in the lives of many of our priests, religious, and lay people. These changes can be seen in the parishes, especially the increasing number of parishioners frequenting the Eucharistic celebration and receiving communion. The devotion to the Blessed Mother Mary and to the Sacred Heart of Jesus is becoming more popular, and we hear many stories of repentance. I also see the changes and improvements in the pastoral lives of some priests, preparing and celebrating the Mass with more love and attention. The messages from Naju touch on important pastoral issues. I myself have read the messages, and I consider them to be very actual and correspond to our spiritual needs. The sharing of Yulia's faith and the spread of the Naju messages have helped us love and appreciate more the mystery of the Eucharist and the Sacrament of Penance and pray the Rosary. May the Naju messages be heard and many return to God again. Amen. Signed, Eduardus Sangsun, SVD, Bishop of Ruteng, June 14, 2007.
The NBC TV report on November 13, 2007 claimed that the water from the spring on the Blessed Mother's Mountain was contaminated with germs and not fit to drink. They did not say where the water sample was tested, but only showed that it was collected on October 26, which was 5 days before they first came to Naju to collect information. It was not possible to confirm their claims. Alarmed at this report, the city of Naju ordered a closure of the spring and ordered an official examination of the water. On November 15th, the city officials came to Naju and collected water samples from the Blessed Mother's spring in the presence of several volunteer workers in Naju. This official test showed that the water from the Blessed Mother's spring in Naju was completely free from any germs and harmful minerals. It also showed that this water had a mild alkalinity, indicating that it was conducive to human health. Of course, the supernatural effects of the water could not be tested. This official test result from the city of Naju is strong evidence that NBC distorted the true facts about the spring water in Naju. On September 25, 2000, this lady seen at left, named Jung Jabum, age 50, had a quarrel with her husband, seen at right. She was so upset that she drank herbicide to kill herself. Her husband found her in critical condition and took her to a hospital. The doctors refused to treat her because they saw no possibility of recovery and gave her up for dead. Then one of their relatives brought her water from the Blessed Mother's spring in Naju and fed her some of it. The next morning, the woman's blood pressure became normal and her general condition gradually improved. The doctors were totally amazed and said that this was a miracle. Soon, she fully regained her health and restored peace and harmony in her family as well. On December 14, 1999, this boy, age 11, went to school as usual. But soon after class began, he swallowed the milk through his breathing pipe and collapsed. When his mother arrived at the hospital, doctors told her that her son was dying and did not have any chance of survival. She begged the doctors to keep him in the intensive care unit and prayed. The next day, one of the staff at the hospital, who had been visiting Naju, brought water from the Blessed Mother's spring and fed some to the boy. Soon he regained consciousness and gradually recovered. His mother says that his condition has continued to improve and he goes to school every day. In May 1999, a young girl suffered a severe burn at a restaurant from hot soup spilled on her legs. Her mother applied the water from Naju to the girl's legs, and her wounds completely healed in 3 weeks. Her grandmother, who had been a Buddhist, saw this and converted to Catholicism. The reason why the Blessed Mother, the mother of all the children in the world, has shed tears is that she loves them so much. She has even shed tears of blood because her love for us is beyond our imagination. God sent us His only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins. The Blessed Mother, who assists her Divine Son by drawing people to Him, needed a humble little soul who would pray and do penance for the countless children in the world who commit sins and yet do not even know their sinfulness, and asked her Divine Son for such a helper. Her prayer was granted, and she chose Julia Kim as a helper to herself. Julia has suffered extreme pains for the sake of sinners. Many times she was very close to death, but as she graciously offered up her sufferings, saying, "I belong to the Lord whether I live or die, may the Lord's will be done," the Lord gave her a special gift and sign on the first Saturday of October 2000. It was the special phenomena that have occurred to her body fluid or urine.
I have visited Naju many times over a number of years. For a long time, I did not know about the unusual phenomena in Julia's urine. Most people think of urine as a dirty waste from our body. I thought so too. But when I witnessed that God even changes this into something so beautiful and precious, I realized how proud I had been when I thought that I knew God. I have never seen Julia's urine, but because so many people are wondering and asking about it after seeing MBC TV's coverage, we are now shown this new video to help us know the true facts about it. No matter how I explain it with words, one cannot understand it well without actually seeing it for himself. I cannot believe MBC TV's fabricated story and slander. When I saw the facts presented in this new video, all my suspicions disappeared. Through the amazing phenomena in Julia's body fluid, I realized again the greatness and mercy of God. If one's mind is filled with prejudice, the phenomena in Julia's body fluid may be difficult to understand. Maybe this is why our Lord wants simple, childlike faith from us. Scientists want to prove everything, but our faith is not an object of scientific proof, but of our belief. On January 1, 2002, the Lord showed Julia indescribably beautiful rays of light of many colors at the 12th station of the cross, and the Blessed Mother explained them in a message to her.
The amazing phenomena in Julia's body fluid are a gift from God who has promised to be with us always. Julia herself is only an instrument of the Lord, being used just for a short while. Knowing this, she has asked others again and again to keep secret the phenomena of her urine during her lifetime. This current video has been prepared despite Julia's strong reservation about revealing the facts of her urine, only because so many people are deceived by the fabrications in NBC TV's video regarding Julia's urine, and as a result, even alienate themselves from the Blessed Mother of Naju. NBC TV even fabricated a scene of several women sitting around the table and drinking some yellowish liquid in small glasses, hoping for better health. NBC TV, one of the largest TV stations in Korea, did not hesitate to manufacture and spread such false information, and thereby mislead so many clergy, lay people, and even those outside the church. Lord, please forgive them, because they do not know what they are doing. On November 2, 2007, at about 3 p.m., a woman in her early 40s, pretending to be a pilgrim but actually sent by NBC TV, approached a volunteer helper in the chapel in Naju carrying a hidden video camera. She told the volunteer helper that she was worried about the possibility of her husband's infidelity and even of bringing home his child born out of wedlock. And that was why she came to Naju to ask for prayers so that she could have her own baby. She asked the volunteer helper to arrange a meeting with Julia, but the volunteer helper asked her to write a letter instead. She also asked the volunteer helper if she could make an offering with a personal check. The volunteer helper said yes. NBC TV then edited and broadcast this video footage to make it appear that Julia was demanding and collecting money in return for her prayers. The true fact is that Julia has never asked for money in return for prayers or accepted any money as payment for prayers. NBC TV also stated that the wealth of Julia and Julio, her husband, kept increasing along with their rising reputation. During the NBC reporter's visit to Naju, the financial records of Julia and Julio's assets were shown to them. They saw that Julia and Julio's wealth was much less than they expected, and only said in the video that their wealth increased many times, referring to the rise in the market value of the land which Julia and Julio owned at the site for the future basilica and which they intend to donate to the church when Naju is officially approved. The total amount of the property tax paid by Julia and Julio last year was about 325,000 Korean won, or $325. This amount is less than the typical tax paid by an owner of a small apartment in the Naju area. NBC's exaggeration and distortion seem quite excessive. In its video, NBC continued to promote the viewers' suspicion by saying, "How could Julia and Julio, who are not employed, raise the money to buy land on the mountain?" The fact is that Julio, who worked for the city of Naju for many years, retired in 1999. With his substantial retirement payment, Julio purchased the land on the mountain. He also continues to receive a pension every year from the city of Naju. NBC TV ignored all these facts in reporting on Julia and Julio's finances. The video produced by NBC TV also contained a testimony by a woman who claimed to be a local resident of Sinkwangri, which is the name of the area where the Blessed Mother's Mountain is located. The woman said that Julio Kim was making money by not paying taxes. The village head of Sinkwangri, however, watched NBC TV's video and testified as follows. He said that this woman appearing in the video was a stranger to his village, and that NBC was promoting division and discord in his village by spreading false information. In its video, NBC TV portrayed the descent of the Holy Eucharist during Bishop Paul Kim's visit to the chapel in Naju on June 12, 1997, as a fake. The scenes of Bishop Kim's visit and the miracle he witnessed were recorded by a video camera installed inside the chapel. This camera is turned on at every important occasion, such as an overnight prayer meeting, a bishop's visit, and so on. Of course, nobody can anticipate or predict the occurrence of miracles. During Bishop Paul Kim's visit, Julia wiped sweat from her forehead with a white handkerchief and then put it back in her pocket. NBC TV played this footage in reverse to make Julia look like she was taking out the white handkerchief from her pocket just before the Eucharist came down to the altar before the Blessed Mother statue. What NBC TV did was a deceptive act of altering someone else's video footage to damage others' reputation. NBC TV also interviewed a self-appointed witness, Tina Kim, who was a driver for Father Anthony Kim, who came with the bishop. Tina Kim testified before several priests of the Gwangju Archdiocese that she saw Julia taking a host out of her pocket and throwing it to the altar before the Blessed Mother statue to fake a miraculous descent of the Eucharist. Later, she reversed her words several times, saying that she was not sure of what really happened. Tina Kim also testified that there were only three people in the chapel, Bishop Paul Kim, Father Anthony Kim, and herself, when the reported miracle occurred. But there actually were more than 10 people in the chapel at that time. There also were other, more credible witnesses who heard Archbishop Victorinus Yun, the ordinary of Gwangju at that time, say that he did not believe Tina Kim's testimony, because if Julia had hurriedly taken a large host out of her pocket and thrown it forcefully, it would surely have been damaged. But the host in question did not even have any damage at all. Also, Victorina Oh, a volunteer helper in Naju who helped Julia get dressed before going out to the chapel to greet the bishop, testified that there was nothing in Julia's pocket that day except a white handkerchief. The Lord and the Blessed Mother who came to Naju have given us numerous miraculous signs to confirm the authenticity of the messages. These signs are perfect gifts and precious and marvelous signs from God. Among them, some of the most significant ones are the miraculous change of the Eucharistic species into visible flesh and blood during the Mass celebrated by His Holiness Pope John Paul II, the miraculous descents of the Eucharist during the visit of the Apostolic Pronuncio Archbishop Giovanni Bulaitis, the Eucharistic miracle during Bishop Roman Danilek's visit, the Eucharistic miracle in Sibu, Malaysia, witnessed by Bishop Dominic Su, and the miraculous descent of the Eucharist during Bishop Paul Kim's visit to Naju. So far, the Eucharist miraculously came down in Naju 13 times. The Eucharistic species of bread and wine turned into visible flesh and blood 12 times, and the sacred host bled 3 times. On November 24, 1994, while the Apostolic Pronuncio was praying in the chapel together with several priests and about 70 lay people, St. Michael the Archangel brought a large sacred host, and a few minutes later, a small sacred host came down and wrapped in light. The Apostolic Pronuncio, Archbishop Blaitis, believed in these miracles and sent detailed reports to the Holy See. In May 2001, Ms. Judy Navarrete, a resident of Los Angeles, California, and a group of several pilgrims went to Italy and saw a display of the photographs of the Eucharistic miracle through Julia in the Vatican, displayed in Our Lady of Grace Church above the Cape of St. Michael the Archangel near San Giovanni Rotondo, St. Padre Pio's shrine. These photographs and the explanation in Italian were displayed along with other church-approved Eucharistic miracles, such as those in Lanciano and Orvieto. The Italian travel guide explained that the miracle through Julia involved the Holy Father, and therefore this exhibit must have required the permission of the Holy See. While still in Italy, Judy and her companions were surprised again when they saw on Italian Catholic TV a report on the miracles in Naju, Korea. It included the Eucharistic miracle in the Vatican, witnessed by Pope John Paul II, and other miracles in Naju. The pilgrimage guide repeated that Such a broadcast would not have been possible without the Holy See's permission, because it involved the Holy Father as a witness of the miracle.
Si intravede chiaramente l'ostia che scende dalla parte sinistra della volta della cappella, attraversa la navata, oltrepassa la statuetta della Madonna e infine si dirige in senso contrario verso i fedeli raccolti in preghiera.
The following is a translation of the Italian text displayed in Our Lady of Grace Church explaining the Eucharistic miracle in the Vatican.
The Lord manifested this marvelous Eucharistic miracle before the eyes of John Paul II, or rather, he was one of the main participants of the supernatural phenomenon. On October 31, 1995, the Pontiff celebrated Holy Mass at 7:30 a.m. in his private chapel. Those present by invitation were some pilgrims, among whom were Monsignor Dionisio Peck, secretary of the Bishops' Conference of South Korea, the seminarian Raphael Song, and Julia Yun, her husband and daughter, all of South Korea. This Julia is the mystic of Naju, where in a chapel she receives messages from the Virgin Mary, in which the Pontiff has shown interest. Also present was Monsignor Vincent Tu, Vietnamese, private secretary of the Holy Father. During communion, Julia received the host from the hands of the Pontiff, and did not succeed in swallowing it, for it began to swell and to taste of blood. Then she opened her mouth to Monsignor Beck, who noted that the host was converted into live flesh and blood. John Paul II was not at all startled, but marveled and observed the phenomenon, and then lovingly blessed the mystic. The Eucharistic phenomenon, although echoed among those present, was kept secret for around 2 years, so as to avoid any sensationalistic clamors.
It is significant that these two public presentations in Italy of the information about the miraculous signs through Julia Kim of Naju appeared in May 2001, 3 years after the Gwangju Archdiocese issued its negative declaration on Naju in January 1998. It seems that Pope John Paul II expressed his desire that the Catholic hierarchy in Korea accept Naju. On September 17, 1996, there was a mass in the cathedral in Cebu, Malaysia, concelebrated by Bishop Dominic Su and other priests in his diocese and attended by about 3,000 people. During this mass, the Eucharist received by Julia turned into visible flesh and blood in her mouth, giving off the odor of blood. The following is the testimony by Bishop Dominic Su of Cebu, Malaysia.
What happened in Cebu on the 17th of September 1996 has nothing to do with the Bishop of Gwangju. It is the jurisdiction of the Bishop of Cebu to see to the matter. It has always been my belief in the real presence of Jesus in the Eucharist. I do not need any scientific proof to convince me. In my humble opinion and judgment, I would consider this extraordinary Eucharistic phenomenon as a Eucharistic miracle.
On July 1, 1995, at about 3:40 a.m., during the overnight prayer meeting in commemoration of the 10th anniversary of the Blessed Mother's first shedding tears in Naju, the precious blood from the seven wounds of Jesus turned into seven sacred hosts and came down on the altar before the Blessed Mother statue in the chapel. On the next day, July 2, these seven sacred hosts were consumed by two priests and five lay people in obedience to the local archbishop's order. The last sacred host received by Julia turned into visible flesh and blood on her tongue, which was witnessed by two priests and many lay pilgrims. After confirming that the sacred host had turned into visible flesh and blood on Julia's tongue, Father Francis Su from Malaysia dipped his finger in the precious blood and showed it to the people in the chapel. Then he wiped his finger with a white handkerchief. This handkerchief stained with blood was sent to a DNA laboratory in Seoul on November 8, 2006. The test showed that the blood belonged to a male human, and its DNA makeup was identical to those of the following 8 samples examined on October 24, 2006. Powder of blood-stained cloth that Julia received from the Lord on February 28, 2001. Blood stain on a small rock witnessed by Bishop Dominic Su on August 15, 2002. Bloodshed on May 6, 2005 from the Sacred Host that came down on April 16, 2005. Precious blood that came down on the area where little stones stained with the precious blood are preserved. September 17, 2006. Precious blood that came down on Julia's room on October 15, 2006. Precious blood collected with a syringe at the area where little stones stained with the precious blood are preserved. October 19, 2006. Precious blood that exuded from Jesus' feet on the crucifix on the Blessed Mother's Mountain on October 19, 2006. One of the little stones with the precious blood on it, witnessed by Bishop Dominic Su, which remained uncoagulated for 140 days. The DNA test on October 24, 2006 showed that all 8 of these samples of blood and the blood from the Eucharistic miracle on July 2, 1995 belong to one same male human with type AB. This matches the blood from the Eucharistic miracle in Lanciano as well as from the Shroud of Turin, the burial cloth of our Lord. This is consistent with our belief that the samples taken from all of these different miracles belong to one same person, our Lord Jesus Christ. The chief examiner at the DNA test company in Seoul said that he was sure that the same results would be obtained regardless of where in the world the test was done. He said that the probability of obtaining identical DNA makeups between two random blood samples is less than 1 in 10 billion. To the NBC TV reporters, Julia and her volunteer helpers gave a huge amount of information. Despite the abundance of the materials they already received, the reporters also asked for the precious blood which came down on the dining table in Julia's home where several priests and others were conversing, and soon coagulated in the form of a saddle and even jumped several times on the table. They kept asking for this coagulated blood, but Julia said she could not give it to them because it was so special and unique. In their TV report on Naju, they accused Julia of refusing to comply with their request for samples for DNA tests.
어떻게, 안 되겠습니까? 안
The NBC TV reporters did see the fragrant oil flowing down on the Blessed Mother's face while they were in the chapel. One of the reporters held the Blessed Mother's statue and pressed firmly on the top of the Blessed Mother's head with his finger to see if he could make more oil come out. Then he asked Julia to allow him to take the statue to his company in Seoul for examination. Julia said that they could bring their equipment to the chapel, but she could not hand over the statue to them. In their video, NBC accused Julia of refusing its request to examine the fragrant oil from the statue as if she had something to hide. 8 years prior to NBC TV's report in October 1999, another major TV network in Korea, SBS TV, did order a test of the fragrant oil in Naju at a laboratory and broadcasted the result. This report concluded that the fragrant oil in Naju might be a new substance different from any oil that exists on Earth. Dr. Jongshin Yu at Laboratory for Supporting the Basic Sciences.
We found a small amount of fatty acid compounds that can be obtained from various kinds of animals and plants. We also found some shiny oil, which we tried to match with candle wax, or olive oil frequently used in religious ceremonies, and other edible oils, but it did not match with any of them.
On November 24, 1994, Archbishop Giovanni Bulaitis, the apostolic pronuncio in Korea at that time, visited Naju and witnessed 2 miraculous descents of the Holy Eucharist in the chapel. In the evening of the same day, Julia went to Wonmidong Church in Incheon to give her testimony. While speaking in the church, Julia unknowingly dropped a small piece of white linen that had absorbed some of the fragrant oil in Naju, which she had put between the pages of the Bible that she often carried with herself. After Julia left, someone found a small piece of linen on the church floor and gave it to the pastor. The pastor smelled fragrance from this linen and immediately thought that it must have been the source of the fragrance that had been filling the church during Julia's visit. His suspicion grew deeper and he continued telling others that Julia was carrying a piece of linen to simulate the miracle of fragrance. Eventually, the pastor even began saying that Julia could also be carrying a small bottle of fragrant oil with her all the time. The pastor testified to NBC TV reporters that Julia was fabricating the miracle of fragrance. There are several reasons why the pastor's suspicion is not justified. First, Julia never carries on her body any linen pieces that absorb fragrant oil or any bottle containing oil. The small piece of linen that she dropped in Wonmidong Church was between the pages of her Bible and not on her body. Second, fragrance from the small piece of linen that had absorbed fragrant oil is weak and cannot fill the church or any large room with a powerful fragrance. Many individuals have received this linen piece from Naju and can testify that the fragrance is not strong enough to fill a church. Third, the fragrance from the oil and the fragrance of roses in Naju smell different. Anyone can easily distinguish between the smell of oil and the smell of fresh flowers. The odor that filled Wonmidong Church was the fragrance of roses, not of oil. Fourth, the miraculous phenomena of fragrance associated with Naju have occurred not only near Julia, but also even hundreds of miles away from her. When people read the Book of Messages in their homes, pray before the statue or photograph of the Blessed Mother of Naju, tell others about the Blessed Mother of Naju, or pray the rosary together with other pilgrims on the bus to Naju. The phenomena of fragrance are very frequent signs experienced by many pilgrims to Naju, regardless of their locations. It simply does not make any sense, and even can be slanderous to attempt to explain away all these signs as human fabrications. SBS TV also performed a test on the fragrance in Naju by hiring an expert on fragrances. The results were broadcasted on October 10, 1999.
향기는 눈에 보이지 않는 만큼 좀 더 정밀한 분석을 위해 향기 전문가를 동행해서
The following is a report by one of the SBS staff.
I could really smell the fragrance. As fragrance is not something visible, I was accompanied by a specialist in fragrances. We collected the air while we could smell a strong fragrance 3 times in 2 days. The air samples were sent to a laboratory. Interestingly, the test instruments did not detect any fragrance from the air samples.
The test instrument is capable of detecting any odor, whether it is natural odor or an artificial one. The fact that the fragrance in Naju was not recognized by the test instrument indicates that the fragrance in Naju may not be of this world. Archbishop Andrew Cheb Gwangju explained in the decree he issued in January 2008 that one of the reasons why he issued the decree was that Julia and Julio Kim were not complying with the conditions stated in his ultimatum of February 2005. In that ultimatum, Archbishop Che asked Julia and her husband to resume their normal faith life in the parish and to present their detailed financial records to him through the parish. Julio prepared the required papers and went to the parish office of Naju hoping that he and Julia could return to the parish. But the pastor refused to accept his papers. The pastor only repeated his earlier demands that Julia and Julio bring the Blessed Mother statue to him, close down the Blessed Mother chapel and mountain, and announce before the parishioners during a Sunday Mass that they had been fabricating the messages and miracles and promised not to do so ever again. The pastor said that Julia and Julio would be allowed to return to church only when they met all these conditions. These were impossible conditions for Julia and Julio because they were tantamount to betraying the Lord and the Blessed Mother, as well as their own conscience. By imposing impossible conditions, the pastor of Nauvoo expelled Julia and her husband from the parish. Archbishop Andrew Che also knew about this, but he only continued making the incorrect accusation that Julia was not leading her normal faith life in her parish. Julia and Julio Kim sent a letter to Archbishop Che in March 2005, but the Archbishop only issued a pastoral letter 2 months later, declaring that the events in Nauvoo had, quote, nothing to do with the Catholic Church. In his decree of January 2008, Archbishop Andrew Che also accused Julia and her supporters of announcing the construction of the basilica requested by Our Lady and collecting money. The fact is, however, that nobody has announced the construction of the basilica or collected money for that purpose. Raising funds and beginning the construction of the basilica will be possible only after the official approval of Nauvoo by the church. All the pilgrims know this and also know that the Archbishop's accusation is not true. The Nauvoo supporters are also accused of having criticized the Gwangju Archbishop and other bishops in Korea, but all they have done is to point out the apparent serious doctrinal errors concerning the Holy Eucharist in the Declaration on Nauvoo, and to call for an investigation of this and, if necessary, to correct it. They have also pointed out that the previous investigation of Nauvoo by the Gwangju Archdiocesan Committee was deficient, in that it did not order any scientific tests, and it totally ignored the opinions of Pope John Paul II and several bishops who had personally witnessed the Eucharistic miracles and other signs through Julia. The Gwangju Archdiocese has emphasized obedience and unity in the Church, but are they really interested in unity and obedience when they ignore the Holy Father, bishops in other countries, and countless other witnesses? Canon law allows the faithful to voice their concerns and requests to the shepherds concerning the faith and for the common good in the Church. The supporters of Nauvoo know that they have the obligation to obey their bishops and priests, but they also know that this teaching authority in the Church is an instrument for defending and promoting God's truth and is not above the truth, as clearly taught in the Catechism of the Catholic Church. True unity in the Church is possible only when it is based on the truth. Unity that stands on errors is not true unity and will not be pleasing to God. As the Gwangju Archbishop's decree of January 2008 distorts the facts of Nauvoo and is based on the declaration, which seems to contain serious errors on the Holy Eucharist, the validity of this decree is in serious doubt. The decree also fails to conform to the following canon law.
A legislator is not to threaten automatic penalties, unless perhaps against certain particularly treacherous offenses, which either can result in more serious scandal, or cannot be effectively punished by means of inflicted penalties. A legislator is not to establish censures, especially excommunication, except with the greatest moderation, and only for more serious offenses.
Father Aloysius Hongbin Chang.
I saw the Blessed Mother's tears in Nauvoo for the first time in 1991, and experienced a profound conversion. I gave up golf, smoking, and card games, and have made more efforts to pray and spend more time in preparation for Mass. I have also made myself more available to those who want to make their confession. Lately, however, there is a vicious false rumor widely spread through the Catholic TV and news media that I have been excommunicated. I am still allowed to continue my priestly function of celebrating Mass every day. How is this an excommunication? It is not true that I have been excommunicated. I became a priest to witness to the Lord's truths, as the Lord himself came to this world to witness to the truth. Therefore, I cannot deny the truthfulness of the Blessed Mother of Naju under any persecutions. The truth of Naju will be made known before long.
The Lord and the Blessed Mother chose Julia Kim as an instrument for giving us more grace and more love. Naju is truly a holy place where we carry the cross following the Lord and the Blessed Mother. The sick are cured, the wounded are consoled, and the broken families regain love and peace. Those who make pilgrimages to Naju are not vain people who only seek miracles out of curiosity. Instead, they make diligent efforts to become more lowly and humble people, like children, and abandon every vain attachment in their daily lives. Saint Francis de Sales said the following:
"Many have been greatly mistaken as to this condition of obedience, believing that it consisted in doing at random whatever should be commanded, even were it contrary to the commandments of God and of the Holy Church. In all that relates to the commandments of God, just as superiors have no power whatever to give any contrary command, so in such a case, inferiors have no obligation to obey. Indeed, if they did so, they would sin."
Naju has withstood the ever-intensifying persecutions over the past 23 years. If the messages and signs in Naju were false, they would have disappeared long ago under the heavy persecutions. God's work, however, cannot be destroyed or blocked by human power or the devil's attacks. The fact that the number of pilgrims continues increasing despite the persecutions, and the number of people experiencing true conversion, restoring their faith, and peace and love in their families is also on the rise. These must be the most convincing evidence of the divine origin of the events in Naju. When Naju is officially recognized by the Church and more clergy and religious also participate in practicing and promoting the messages in Naju, which are only faithful echoes of the Lord's gospel messages 2,000 years ago, many more souls will be saved and peace and love will replace hatred, violence, and other moral problems in this world. Let us pray hard that the obstacles be removed and Naju be officially approved as soon as possible. When God sends us so many important messages and signs as in Naju, He must have a very serious reason and a very important goal. We have no doubt that this divine goal is nothing else than a worldwide conversion of all people to the true Catholic faith and the restoration of true peace, harmony, and charity among all the peoples in the world.